mentioned, you can have some idea what you're dealing with. Again, in Bono series in aortic regurgitation, out of 104 patients, almost 58 plus minus 9% alive, symptomatic patients with normal LV function over 8 years, total of 490 patients followed over for 6.4 years. Rate of progression of LV diction was 4.3% per year. Progression to asymptomatic LV dysfunction was 1.3% per year, and mortality was only 49%. What does it mean? That if your patient is asymptomatic for AR, he has got good prognosis, which is the case with all valvular disease. If the patient gets symptomatic, the survival is poor. If the patient has asymptomatic disease, then it means that the patient has not come and told you symptoms of AR. It means that the patient is actually going to do well, and he probably does not have a dominant AR lesion, which you are auscultating or able to find out from pulse pressure, etc. But when you look at the mortality, asymptomatic with normal function will have very low mortality, less than 0.2%. But asymptomatic with LV dysfunction will have symptomatic conversion or 25% every year. So once the AR develops LV dysfunction, it's very likely the patient is now going to be symptomatic. But once you're symptomatic, you have more than 10% per year mortality. Now, again, this I mentioned in the previous slide, the palpitation and dyspnea comparison. If, how do you differentiate volume overload, palpitation, which the patient perceives as increased precordial activity, which you have to call and define as precordial activity, versus palpitation. Now, when you define the characteristic, again, there are two important things that you also look at to differentiate whether you're dealing with exertional rise, intermittent rise, and irregularity rise. So once then, so you have arrhythmia, like you have natriuresis, which goes again and tells you SVT. You have irregular beats, which sudden onset, sudden offset, again tells you. But how do you differentiate dyspnea versus palpitation? This correlation is important. If dyspnea is occurring before palpitation, it means that the arrhythmia is induced by hypoxia, which is usually sinus tachycardia. So patients who have yet to develop full-blown heart failure, their first manifestation, like you find in COVID, these patients in COVID, their common manifestation is minimal activity and they get tachycardia. So that's again a sign of myocarditis. These patients will have a disproportionate or hypoxia, either way. So dyspnea that precedes palpitation means that the hypoxia has induced sinus tachycardia. But if palpitation precedes dyspnea, it means that the tachycardia has shortened cycle enough to compromise output, and hence it's a electrical problem. That is like atrial fibrillation. So history can help in identifying arrhythmia supraventricular by presence of post-arrhythmia diuresis, or its termination by vagal maneuvers like diving reflex or vagal maneuvers can terminate it. Third thing people say is bending forward is one of the initiator and triggers. So onset offset of palpitation, like irregular pounding of the heart, is AF. Gradual onset, gradual offset is sinus tachycardia, and rapid onset, abrupt termination is another tachyarrhythmias like VT or a SVT. Pain in abdomen in cardiac patients. A lot of times you think, what is this? It's distracting. It's not. It's usually talking about the right heart. So pain in the abdomen causes can be stretching of Glisson's capsules because of the chronic passive congestion. Drug induced like digitalis or CCBs, both like verapamil, can cause abdominal pain. Congestive enteropathy. Systemic inflammatory interleukins, like again you see in COVID, that interleukin is responsible for GI manifestations or TNF-alpha, and can be manifestation, of course, and if you remember the original rheumatic criteria, Jones criteria, it described epistaxis and abdominal pain were considered as a minor criteria, but they were gone after the first Jones revision came. So original Jones talked about it, and rheumatic fever can manifest with abdominal pain. Anorexia can again be because of all of these conditions which I just mentioned above. So paradoxical dyspnea relief, as I mentioned, was the mechanism, was the primarily, as I said, the shortening of the diastole that you get in AR. The PND, there are various mechanisms. I'm just touching upon them quickly, though that's not the talk of the day. But redistribution, as people talk, is the commonest etiology. But very importantly, in the sleep, the sympathetic tone is withdrawn, and hence the heart that is working at the peak of the Frank-Starling curve will actually have worsening and of the heart failure and development of PND. Nocturnal arrhythmia, especially AF, sleep-associated respiratory depression, and RAM activity and sleep-associated dreams are the other mechanisms that happen. Now, hemodynamic correlates are important. So once you are going to describe your patient is having this dominant lesion or that dominant lesion, you'll have to correlate it with X-ray. If you're not getting that finding in X-ray, that means you're making up the diagnosis or you know it through the echocardiograph. So for that hemodynamic correlation, you should remember this table. Class 1 patients usually asymptomatic. Their wedge is usually less than 12 and hence the x-ray would be normal. Once the wedge pressure starts rising, first thing that will happen due to gravity, as we know in the lungs normally, the blood is more into the middle and the lower lobes and the air is more there in the upper lobe. But once the congestion starts, the unfilled upper part will get filled up. So there is equal or equalization or redistribution or equalization of pulmonary veins in the upper lobe. And this is also called as upper lobe redistribution or antler sign or Staghorn sign or equalization or upper lobe redistribution as it is called. This usually happens when the wedge pressure is between 12 to 18. These patients are usually functionally class 2. Once the patient develops PND or he has functional class 3, the wedge is usually in the range of 18 to 25. Once that is the case, the pathology, of course, is the interstitium. Now, instead of venous congestion, the congestion is now headed into the interstitium of the lung. And hence, in the chronic cases, the over-hypertrophied or hypertrophied lymphatics will come in to clear the interstitium. Once they become calcified, an X-ray, these calcified, hypertrophied lymphatics trying to clear the interstitium will appear in X-ray like curly B lines. So curly B lines represent nothing but hypertrophied interstitial lymphatics, and hence it represents interstitial edema, which is mechanism of PND, and hence PND is called as equivalent to class 3, but PND actually does not fall into the NYHA classification. Class 4 is development of alveolar edema. Now the congestion has now gone beyond the interstitium into the alveoli, and hence the alveoli are now flooded. And the patient is now orthopneic because he doesn't have the ability to exchange the gases. And hence, there is dyspnea at rest, patient's wedge is more than 25, and there is a backswing appearance. So once you have diagnosed for patients with no history of ARF, that these are the RHD criteria that have come in. We know that now, I'm just touching upon them. The definite RHD is one of the following. You have pathologic MR, at least two morphologic MV features of RHD, mean gradient, pathologic AR. Development of AR with at least two morphologic findings, age less than 20, bicuspid aortic valve AR must be excluded. In individuals less than 20, borderline disease, both aortic and mitral valve with combined AR, MR, again, you should suspect as rheumatic. And for individuals less than 35, a pathologic AR and at least two morphologic findings of RHD of the aortic valve, where the other bicuspid or dialytic root have been excluded, all will fall into definite RHD criteria. Now, in India, we know that most of the patients are younger, multivalvular, recurrent episodes, rapid progression, high incidence of AF, embolism, CCF, and they require lifelong prophylaxis and treatment. Once we understand this aspect, we can then understand how the disease progression happens. And we also have to know that in India or in the overall rheumatic presentation, isolated mitral valve disease can itself be responsible for 70 to 75%. Percent of the patients. So which again means that a single valve disease does not rule out non-rheumatic etiology, especially for mitral valve disease. Mitral aortic both are involved in 25, isolated aortic can still happen in 5 to 8%, and tricuspid is very common in India of 30 to 50% in autopsy series is shown to have the same. And in India, in Manjunath series, as we know, the mitral valve is involved in 60%, and it was exclusive etiology in almost 97%. So a degenerative calcification was most common cause of isolated AS followed by bicuspid aortic valve. And we know for the multiple valves, more than one third of the cases, it's a multivalvular disease where MS-MR is the commonest, followed by MS with AR, followed by MR with AR, followed by AS with AR, followed by MR with AS, and the rarest is MS with AS. So commonest is MS-MR, rarest is MS-AS. These two you should remember. MS plus MR is commonest, and MS plus AS is least common. Now coming to the important, once you understood this from symptomatology and the chronology and the frequency and epidemiology of valvular heart disease, now we proceed to the examination. So we are clear as to what we are dealing with based on symptomatology and epidemiology frequency wise that what you are anticipating. Now what happens to the pulse in mitral stenosis? In mitral stenosis, very likely you may have atrial fibrillation. If the atrial fibrillation is present, you are sure that you are dealing with at least moderate mitral stenosis or at least moderately severe mitral regurgitation. You don't get AF in mild MS, which is usually very rare in young patients. In old age patients, it can still happen. But AF usually tells you, though it does not go with the severity, it can happen in even moderate MS. But it should not mean that the presence of AF always signifies severe MS. You can get even moderate MS developing AF. only exception of sinus rhythm is in patients with severity of MS is juvenile MS. In juvenile mitral stenosis, even severe MS is not associated with AF. So you may be asked, AF not being associated with severity, the exception is juvenile mitral stenosis. Mitral regurgitation, you will get collapsing pulse. You should know what's the difference between the water hammer and the collapsing. Collapsing pulse, you don't have the systolic rising. In AR, you will always have higher systolics and lower diastolics, and hence wide pulse pressure. You have still a wide pulse pressure in MR, but it's a rapid upstroke and rapid downstroke that you find in MR with systolics not so high, but diastolics still going down. So pulse pressure is slightly increased as compared to vastly increased in severe chronic AR. In AS, you can have all types of pulses. A for anachronic, B for bisparians, D for alternans and parvocyte tardus. And it all is needs to be explained as to what condition you get what. Anachronic you get in severe AS. Bisparians you have associated moderate MR, AR. In alternans you get once the LV dysfunction sets in. And again, parvocyte tardus is a manifestation of severe LV dysfunction, severe aortic stenosis with preserved LV systolic function. Chronic AR, in AR, you get water hammer and alternans, which are the two kinds of pulses that can be found. So again, depending on what is the dominant lesion, you will have that kind of manifestation on the pulse. So pulse should tell you, if you're getting a patient who's got water hammer characteristics, means you are dealing with a dominant aortic regurgitant lesion. So pulse will tell you the dominant lesion. In aortic stenosis, the condition can pseudo-normalize the arterial pulse in severe AS. So you may get a normal pulse in presence of severe AS. So these conditions you should know. So these are include associated AR, presence of hypertension, high cardiac output conditions, or elastic vessels in children. In children, severe AS can still have normal pulse. So any considered condition which causes decreased cardiac output can exaggerate severity of AS in character on the contrary. So you have moderate AS, but you can look at manifestations of severe AS in a patient, say, who's presented with diarrhea. So when the volume is low, even moderate will start behaving like severe. So in decreased cardiac output or say even LV dysfunction supervening, so in patients with moderately severe AS, it will look like a, behave like a severe AS. So low cardiac output, low volumes can cause moderate to become severe. And in pseudo-normalization, in severe AS, it will appear like normal if there is associated AR, hypertension, high cardiac outputs, like beriberi, anemia, etc., or even elasticity in children. Now, these are the 30 signs that we can talk of in rapid distal runoff. Now, these are signs of rapid distal runoff. These are not signs exclusively of aortic regurgitation, though some of them are specific for aortic regurgitations. But these are the signs that grossly by those who are in fancy of remembering names, they all represent nothing but extremely dilated peripheral vasculature. So you have Alfred de Musset's, which is oscillating or bobbing of the head with systole. You have Lighthouse sign, which is flushing and blanching of the head or the forehead. You have Escherfany's sign, which is pulsatile pseudoproptosis. Landolfi's sign, which is dilatation and contraction of pupil. Baker's sign, which is fundoscopic examination showing the pulsatile retinal vessels. You have Baker's sign. You have Drummond's sign, which is systolic expansion of air, expulsion of the air from the nose when the mouth is closed. So if the patient closes the mouth, the compression on the trachea by the dilated aorta can cause a puff of air coming out from the nose. That is Drummond's sign. You have Buzzolo's sign, which is pulsatile nasal mucosa. You can have Minervini's sign, which is strong lingual pulsation. Which is when the tongue depressor moves up and down when you press the tongue depressor to examine the tongue. Muller's sign is the uvula itself being pulsatile. Then, so all these signs I've mentioned from head to toe so that you can remember them. 30, I know, is a tough job to remember. I'm sure the examiner also doesn't remember. So just you remember some of important ones is what is more important. Corrigan sign, which is pulsatility of supraclavicular or the carotid pulses. Loge sign, which is sternoclavicular pulsations. Due to aortic dissection, that's a specific sign of aortic dissection AR, which is Loge sign, sternoclavicular pulsation. Locomotor brachialis is the pulsatile brachial pulsation. Water hammer pulse is the collapsing pulse, as we demonstrate by holding the radial pulse and against the fist and raising the hand, and you can see a thud like Victorian toy, as it was named after which it was. And Palfrey's sign is pistol shot in the radial, while Palmer click is the palpebra blood flushing with the systole of the palm. Dermatographia is wheel and flare reaction when you scratch on the back. Penny's sign is flushing of wheels at any site. If you have allergic reaction, those sites will flush. You have quinky, quintus quinky and quinky sign. Quinky sign is capillary pulsation nail bed. Again, that is demonstrated by three methods. Either you press the nail bed and see the blanching of the tip, or pressing the side of the tongue, you can see, or you can even see the light thrown at the tip of the nail and you can see the pulsatility of the capillaries. You can have cutis quinqui, as is described by Holden et al. When a mosquito bite in a child was blushing, they picked up a PDA. Rosenbach sign, pulsatile liver. Gerard sign is pulsatile spleen. Dennison sign is pulsatile cervix. Durozier's sign and murmur is supposed to be one of the specific sign. It is basically D4D. Remember, distal compression causes diastolic murmur is Durozier's sign, Durozier's murmur. So all the proximal compression, systolic murmur, and distal compression, diastolic murmur together is called as Durozier's sign. So proximal compression causes systolic murmur and distal compression causes diastolic murmur. Together is called Durozier's sign. Durozier's murmur specifically refers to the diastolic murmur by distal compression. Trope sign is loud systolic pistol shot over the femorals. Hill sign is the difference between the systolic pressures in the two upper limb and the lower limb. Pulsus bisferiens, as we know, the characteristics twice beating systolic pulse. You know how to draw that. Lincoln sign is pulsatile popliteal. Sherman sign is prominent dorsalis pedis in patients who are more than 75 years of age. Shelley's sign is again also described as pulsatility of cervix. Main sign is decrease in the diastolic blood pressure of 15 millimeter when arm is held above the head. Again, it's a non-specific sign. Third point of examination is blood pressure to differentiate between the four disorders. The mitral stenosis, the systolic blood pressure is normal, pulse pressure is narrow, diastolic is normal. The diastolic is normal or raised because of vasoconstriction. That sets in with sympathetic tone rising. Mitral regurgitation, you'll have diastolic low, normal or mildly raised systolic, but a wide pulse pressure. Aortic stenosis, you'll have, depends on systolic blood pressure, it can be variable depending on LV dysfunction, presence of severity of AS, how hypercontractile LV is, there is associated hypertension, it varies. Pulse pressure is always usually narrow in severe AS, unless you have conditions like anemia which supervene and cause wide pulse pressure to behave normal. Diastolic is slightly raised. In AR, of course, we know systolic is high, diastolic is low, and pulse pressure is wide. JVP. In Lancisi's sign, which is basically a clinical sign in which a large venous or giant V wave is visible, is a classical with obliteration of X wave, which is called as ventriculization of JVP. It reflects organic tricuspid valve disease. So when you find giant V, or sometimes it is also called as S wave, when you have a V wave with obliterated X, it is called as an S wave or obliterated or giant V wave. This is called as Lancisi's sign, and it tells you that you're dealing with a severe tricuspid regurgitation, probably of the organic etiology. Again, in TS with TR, that prominent A and absent Y tells you that it's TS, an organic tricuspid disease. While obliteration of X descent and prominent V results in CV fusion with prominent Y descent in TR. So TS is A and TR is Y. So Y descent in TR, prominent A in TS with absent Y. That's how you differentiate whether you're dealing with predominant TS and TR if you get both kind of murmurs in these conditions. So this is how you demonstrate JVP. You lean across the patient. Your torch is held in your one hand. You're standing on patient's right. You flash the light and you lean across to see the skin movements that you find out. So this is how you assess the JVP. The level is difficult to assess despite posture and inclination. If not visible despite, then you compress the lower end of JVP above, just above the clavicle, if the between the two heads of sternocleidomastoid. And if JVP now becomes apparent, it means that it was lying very low in the chest and JVP was low or normal. And if it's still not apparent, it means it is hidden and it's too high behind the ear lobe. So it's not in the just neck, and then it's probably high. So this is one thing that you can do if you can't make out a JVP by compressing between the two heads, despite this mechanism if you're trying to demonstrate. Third is pulmonary hypertension. Now, early PH you can find in mitral stenosis in acute MR, but terminal pH is only what you find in chronic MR. pH is evident in aortic stenosis, then you must suspect MS. As I said, if you're having P2 loud, if you're having diastolic thrill, if you're having parastolic heave, if you're having diastolic shock, then you're probably dealing with a pH in a patient with aortic valve disease where you have a masquerading or a silent mitral stenosis, which is hidden behind. So what are the signs of pH? Signs of pH would be maybe a large A wave in absence of a PS in patients with severe MS. So pH, large A wave or giant A waves are found, not giant, but A wave, prominent A waves in JVP would tell you you're dealing with an MS. Signs of RVH, right ventricular hypertrophy, if you get a parasternal heave, which is not LA heave, which you can get again in parasternal area, which is a late systolic heave, but a pre-systolic heave, if you're getting, then you're dealing with the RV heave, which means it's a PH, or pulmonary stenosis, again, which you can get it. But again, in pulmonary stenosis, the heave is different. Again, that's not the topic here. RV type of apex. RV type of apex is characterized by very important aspect. One is the medial versus lateral retraction. So when the RV is there, the LV is on the left side. So there'll be lateral retraction. So there is lateral retraction means you're dealing with the RV impulse. So lateral retraction, second, diffuse in character. And third, pulsations in the Ziffy sternal area by the thumb at the tip. So these three things tell you whether you're dealing with LV type of apex or you're dealing with RV type of apex. So how do you make out LV type of apex from RV type of apex? Number one, medial or lateral retraction. Lateral retraction you get in RV type. Medial retraction you get in LV type. Number two, diffuse versus localized. Again, this is not a standard rule. You can get diffuse apex of LV as you find in patients with chronic AR or severe AR or severe MR. But usually diffuse characteristic goes with RV, localized character goes with LV. Third thing that you can find in patients with RV type of apex is Ziffy sternal palpation, subcostal palpation by thumb that you insert and you feel the pulsation at the tip of the thumb is a feature of RV type of apex. So when you get RV type of apex, you're suspecting presence of PH. Loud P2 or diastolic shock, and RV heave, and functional or Gram-Stell murmur of PR. So etiology of MR, again, you can differentiate. This I had asked in one of the lectures with you as to how you differentiate the etiology. Remember that in chronic MR, severe MR of rheumatic etiology, the S2 would be widely split. While you get narrow split with loud S1 in MVP. So a splitting of second heart sound rather than the just first heart sound will also tell you. In MR, because there is another outlet, so P2 will split wide. Your A2 will come early and P2 will be delayed because of PH. A2 will come early because of early emptying of the LV into the LA. Normal splitting, you'll find MVP because the loud S1 will also supervene. And in paradoxical, where there is papillary muscle dysfunction or DCM or presence of LVBB, you can actually end up with paradoxical split. This is how you demonstrate parasternal heave on examination by the using the lateral aspect of the hand. And this is how you palpate the diastolic shock, the demonstration of diastolic shock by keeping the thenar and hypothenar eminences at the pulmonary area and feeling the shock. Once you find the presence of shock, it usually means that the PA pressure is more than 50. So P2 is palpable. P2 means peak PA pressure more than 50. So then you cannot say that you're dealing with mild PH. So if you have findings of PH, then you're dealing with something which is at least moderately severe PH. If your RVS3 is present, means you're dealing with severe PH unless there is organic tricuspid disease or if there is a Burnheim effect. So all these findings should corroborate into your diagnosis. S1 again is another important thing. In MS, if it's dominant, your S1 is loud. If it's MR, S1 is soft. In aortic stenosis, it's usually normal or muffled because of the or normal heart sound. In AR again, the S1 is soft. So loud S1, if you speak, means your MS is dominant. If you're loud S1, if you're going to talk about S1 being normal or soft, you cannot say that MS is the dominant lesion. So loud S1 in MR, however, by mistake, if you've said, you can still justify by saying that, sir, I'm hearing in MR because of the tachycardia, or it maybe it's MVP, or maybe simple thing, which is a very tricky answer. And you know, still you can drag the examiner and get a credit. Is, sir, it may be acute rheumatic carditis, which is ongoing. So acute rheumatic carditis, you can, is one paradox where you get loud S1 because of mitral valvitis and you still have predominant MR. So the only condition where you have dominant MR and you have loud S1 with not a severe MS is presence of acute rheumatic carditis or acute rheumatic fever. Anemia and thin walls chills can still have. Another differentiation is presence of S3 from opening snap. So the differences are high pitch versus low pitch, best heard with diaphragm versus bell, respiratory variation. It is not present with opening snap, but it increases with expiration for LVS3. S3 is often palpable. Opening snap is rarely ever palpable. Opening snap is almost never palpable. While LVS3 is soft, opening snap, you will always have S1 loud. So what differentiates S3 from OS? Loud S1, mid-diastolic murmur, respiratory variation. These three things will differentiate primarily, of course, pitch, diaphragm, and presence of MS murmur, all will tell you. But S1 is very important to remember. Palpation of the apex. Now, you again palpate and demonstrate what type of apex you're dealing with. Now, this is the method or photograph which was how it is demonstrated in most of the cardiology books. So palpation from the front is not the technique of demonstrating apex beat palpation. You can see how I have demonstrated it by standing from the back of the patient with patient sitting up. So you can do a palpate from the front, localize where it is, go to the patient's back and hold only with the tip of the middle finger or tip of the index finger as to the apex beat where it is localized. This is the technique of demonstration of apex beat. Now, what is the characteristic of apex beat in various disorders? If you are going to say tapping, that means you're dealing with MS. Then you cannot say MS is not dominant, which means if MS, unless it's a rotated severe PH and rotated backward and RV is forming the apex. MR, it is hyperdynamic. In MR, if you're going to speak dominant MR, you'll have MR reflecting into the LA dilatation because of the regurgitant blood coming. So you'll have to speak probably a LV rock, or you have a parasternal heave, which you then justify as the LA heave rather than the heave of the RV in chronic MR. So if you're, unless you have a moderately severe MS. So if you're going to speak severe MR, you speak of a heave, then that heave is the LA heave, not the RV heave. In AS, you'll get heaving, which is often undisplaced. Your apex beat is still in the fifth intercostal space, unless there is LV dysfunction. In apex beat does not move in AS. In severe AS also, it does not move unless LV dysfunction supervenes. So if AS, your heaving apex is still present in the normal location, in the fifth intercostal space, within 10 centimeter, within the midclavicular line on the left side. In AR, it will go down and out. In MR, it will go down and sometimes out. But it's always outwards if it does go because of RV in mitral stenosis. So apex beat is say 12 centimeter in fifth space, that is MS. Apex beat is seventh or eighth intercostal space or sixth intercostal space. 12 centimeter, then you are dealing with an AR probably, or sometimes with an MR with an LV. So, plus the rock. So, again, you get hyperdynamic apex. What is hyperdynamic? Heaving, forceful and sustained, forceful and not sustained. If you're forceful and not sustained, means you're dealing with volume overload, which is hyperdynamic. Again, once the LV dysfunction supervenes, in both the regurgitant lesions, you can, hyperdynamic can become heaving. So, because of the raised LVEDP, in chronic AR or chronic MR, once the LV dysfunction supervenes, you're dealing with a heaving apex, though the dominant lesion is still a regurgitant lesion. Murmurs. What determines the severity of the murmurs and the severity of the lesions? One, the presence of mitral stenosis. A2OS interval is a very important parameter to differentiate as to what kind of severity you're dealing with in patients with mitral stenosis. Length of the mid-diastolic murmur will also be a proportionate finding in patients with severity of mitral stenosis. So severe MS, you'll also find a long murmur with presystolic accentuation, especially in patients who don't have atrial fibrillation. In mitral regurgitation, mid-diastolic murmur, loud and radiation with extent. So loudness is it matters only in one lesion, MR. Louder the murmur, severe the lesion. MDM, the flow murmur of MR, when MR has got caused severe extent of the blood to regurgitate into the LA, and then this blood comes back into the LV, that causes a mid-diastolic murmur to come in a patient of MR without a significant MS. So you have MR, blood has regurgitated into the LA. Orifice is still normal, and through that now the increased amount of blood is coming back into the diastole from the LA to LV despite normal valve. Because the more blood is coming, you will get a mid-diastolic flow murmur, and that tells you that you're dealing with severe MR. So loud murmur, extremely radiating murmur, and presence of mid-diastolic flow murmur will tell you that you're dealing with severe MR. AS, you will have late peaking of the murmur. So you have late peaking of the murmur, it tells you you're dealing with a severe AS. And in AR, presence of long murmur. Again, the length of the murmur matters in AR and MS. In length of the murmur in AS does not matter, only the peaking of the late murmur matters in AS. In MR, the murmur is always long because there is a transsystolic gradient present. All throughout systole, you have gradient between the LV and LA. So it's the loudness that will matter, radiation that will matter, not the duration of the murmur in MR. MDM of MS versus Austin Flint is one that is commonly asked, the difference between the two. In mitral stenosis, atrial fibrillation is common, which is not so common in AR. If the failure is present for more than 5 years, as I mentioned, you're dealing with mitral stenosis. LA enlargement, you'll find in Austin Flint, is common. LV enlargement, but you don't find LV enlargement in mitral stenosis because LV is underfilled. Presence of PH. So what are the findings of PH? RV heave is present in MS, but not present in Austin Flint. Austin Flint, as you know, it is rare in isolated AR. Usually you have combination, you have only severe AR that leads to development of Austin Flint murmur at the apex. Opening snap is absent, which is present in MS. S3 is present, unlike the mitral stenosis. Amyl nitrate is one of the important differentiating point. Amyl nitrate, because of increased cardiac output and tachycardia and increased cycle, MS murmur increases. But with amyl nitrate, the peripheral dilatation comes in, and the regurgitation fraction decreases in AR, and hence the murmur of AR, the Austin Flint disappears or decreases in presence of amyl nitrate inhalation. Signs of PH, as I said, will go with MS, and peripheral signs of AR will go with Austin Flint. Again, severe MR versus MDM MR. How do you differentiate? Suppose you are getting MDM murmur, and I say you have a patient, you said MS MR, and you say, sir, this is severe MR, and I say, no, this is MS, which is severe. That is what you're hearing. How do you differentiate mid-diastolic flow murmur because of severe MR without MS versus mid-diastolic murmur of MS? So that you can differentiate by presence of S3 versus opening snap. If you are getting S3, you're dealing with MR. If you cannot get an S3 in MS. So S3, again, another important thing is loud. So first heart sound. If first heart sound is loud, then you are dealing with MS. Again, murmur, if it ends before S1, you're dealing with MDM of flow, which can, you know, MDM of MS in a loud MS would extend right up to S1. Pre-systolic accentuation, you'll get it in MDM of mitral stenosis, but not in flow murmur of MR. And thrill is absent. You get thrill in MS, but not in a flow murmurs. Flow murmurs don't cause thrill. And presence of associated MR murmur, pan-systolic murmur, will tell you that you're dealing with a severe MR because it will be a very loud MR murmur. What do you expect in a patient of MS who develops edema ascites without any symptoms of breathlessness? This is a classical finding in Indian settings where the patient has developed organic tricuspid valve disease because of rheumatic activity. What would you suspect in a patient of AS who has developed dyspnea for more than 3 years? Again, this means there is somewhere hidden mitral stenosis which you have missed in the diagnosis. How do you categorize severity of MS clinically? So clinically, mild MS, moderate MS, and severe MS, the old definition, which echocardiographically still holds on, the clinical MS or the critical MS has been defined clinically now less than 1.5. Echocardiographic association still sticks to these values of 1.5 and 1 and less than 1 in echocardiography. But clinically, that doesn't hold true. The anything less than 1.5 is called as significant MS or critical MS or severe MS. But between those three findings, you can differ by presence of PND. Usually does not happen if the area is more than 1.5. Hemoptysis doesn't happen unless you have area less than 1. Then the pulmonary apoplexy will set in. AF can be present in both the condition. Right heart failure, presence of pulse ulcerated in the shock, blood pressure in hypotension, cardiac output is low, JVP is raised with prominent A-wave, A2OS interval less than 0.08, and presence of a long MDM with pre-systolic accentuation with palpable P2RV heave and also Gram-Stell PR murmur all setting in are findings of severe MS, which is not the case with MR. How do you define severity of MR? So I've given 10 points for each of the lesions. For severe MR, wide splitting of first heart sound of the second heart sound. So you have severe MR, hence the A2 is early, P2 remains where it is, and you have wide splitting. Loud P2 means PH is now supervened, again will always happen with severe MR. Palpable S3. S3 will always be there, but if you can palpate S3, you're dealing with severe MR. If you get mid-diastolic flow murmur of MR, that again is a severe MR. Brisk carotid pulse, presence of thrill, development of atrial fibrillation, downward displayed apex, which has now become sustained. As I told you, if you have sustained LV apex in an MR, you're dealing with severe MR or with a supervening early LV dysfunction. Loud or increased intensity of murmur and early and late systolic parasternal impulse, which is because of the LA. So MR has pushed the blood into the LA and you are getting a parasternal heave because of the LA regurgitation. So early parasternal heave will tell you you're dealing with a severe MR. So these are the 10 points of severe MR. Severe AS. Severe AS, you'll get palpable A wave, as it is called, as on pre-systolic impulse at the apex. Paradoxical second heart sound. Presence of S4. Pulsus parvus tardus. Late peaking of the murmur. Long duration of the murmur. Low pulse pressure, which is a non-specific sign. Systolic pressure is more than 200 actually rule out, because you cannot have severe enough stenosis to generate a gradient of 70 plus and you have a blood pressure of 200, which means LV has to generate something like 270, which is very rare, and patient doesn't come with pulmonary edema. Carotid apico-carotid delay of if you can appreciate clinically, means you're dealing with again severe AS. And here, one important, like A2OS interval in MS you have. Here you have S1 EC duration. If you are getting ejection click, say in bicuspid aortic valve, because you don't get it in rheumatic, but in a bicuspid aortic valve, if you are getting an ejection click, if the duration between first heart sound and ejection click is long, it tells you that you're dealing with a severe AS. So presence of each of the first three individually suggests gradient more than 70. You get paradoxical second, presence of S4 or palpable A wave, all of them individually suggest gradient more than 70. Systolic thrill does not indicate severity. It's rather a rule more the common in associated AR. Gallivartin dissociation versus MR. This is another thing. What the murmur you are hearing at apex, you are saying MR, doctor, this is not MR, this is the same AS murmur. So you have to differentiate between the two, and you have to justify it by these following points. One, carotid delay is present in AS. If you have AS and you are getting Gallivartin dissociation, the murmur, you'll have a picocarotid delay. Well, there is no delay if it's pure MR murmur. Radiation to the carotids or the murmur in AS, while it radiates to the axilla or back in presence of MR. Amyl nitrate is one important differentiating point. MR murmur will decrease because of peripheral dilatation and increased forward ejection rather than regurgitation, while AS murmur, because of peripheral dilatation, may become worse. BPC is when they supervene. AS murmur increases, but MR murmur does not change. A2 remains soft in AS. A2 is normal in MR. Heart is at the base, ends before the murmur is heard at the base, while it ends till S2 in presence of MR. Typical apex pulse carotid you find, which you get in the AS, and you also have a normal pulse in S1. So apex beat, character, third heart sound, loud, soft S1, some flow murmur of MDM, all differentiate between these two. And these should be remembered when you're asked differentiating Gallivartin dissociation versus mitral regurgitation. Severity of AR, again, 10 important points. One, people say, is Hill sign more than 60, long diastolic murmur, Bisparian pulse, soft S1, presence of Austin-Flint murmur, presence of peripheral signs, multiple peripheral signs if they are present. If diastolic pressure is less than 50 in presence of hypertension, again, it suggests that you're probably dealing with severity of AR. Forceful and sustained apex beat displayed downward and outwards is another important parameter. Presence of LVS3, presence of ejection murmur, all of them in AR, you get flow murmur, as they say, are feature of severity of AR. Now, two important things people can sometimes ask you, what is diastolic MR and what is systolic AR? The two are paradox. You know, MR is a systolic event, AR is a diastolic event. But when you will get diastolic MR? So diastolic MR, you get an acute AR. When you have acute AR, LV is still non-compliant, mitral valve is still open, and the AR it just that goes back and causes MR. So that is one condition where you get acute diastolic MR. Second thing is LV dyssynchrony. So the pacing that you do, the biventricular pacing, is also to primarily correct the diastolic MR. So in LV dyssynchrony, LV dysfunction, when the depolarization is still taking place enough to, you know, cause the mitral to collapse completely, you can sometime get diastolic MR. But commonly it is found in acute AR. Diastolic MR you find in acute AR. Systolic AR. Now AR usually you get as a diastolic event. But in presence of atrial fibrillation, and more importantly nowadays in ECMO, you can get systolic AR. So ECMO, LV dysfunction with AR, presence of atrial fibrillation, and sometimes in complex congenital heart disease that have been operated, which includes root repair, you can get systolic AR. So these are the two conditions which I thought I should discuss. People can again ask you differentiating between primary PR and Gram-Stahl, which you know is the begins immediately after second heart sound because the PA pressure is high in pulmonary hypertension. So this high PA pressure causes as soon as the diastole begins to regurgitate. So the P2 followed by immediately the murmur tells you Gram-Stahl. While primary PR, RV pressure has to fall enough to cause regurgitation. So primary PR, there'll be a gap between the second heart sound and development of the murmur. Loud P2, diastolic shock, RV heave, all are present in Gram-Stahl, which are not present in primary PR. Acute AR versus chronic AR, sudden onset, normal pulse pressure, normal systolic, normal diastolic, all go with chronic AR, chronic, acute AR, chronic, we know how the differences are. SVR is a different. Heart is normal size, impulse is normal, first heart sound gets soft, P2 may be normal, S3 though is common because of acute failure onset. Murmur is short, there is no Austin Flint murmur, no peripheral signs, X-ray is normal or shows pulmonary congestion. Acute AR will only manifest by the murmur, short murmur and S3 and failure. While chronic, of course, we know how it goes ahead. Systolic murmur of AS versus systolic flow murmur of AR, as I was talking about, more commonly you have thrill. So if you find thrill, you're dealing with ejection murmur of AS. So systolic flow murmur of AR will never be associated with thrill. It's peaks before the second half of the cycle and peripheral signs of AR, because this usually tells you are dealing with a severe AR. Hence you will have peripheral signs of AR when you have systolic flow murmur of AR, but peripheral signs will be absent if it is AS. So peripheral signs tell you where you're dealing with systolic AS murmur associated with the severe AR or without it. So, and where it peaks and whether thrill is present or not. Organic versus functional TR. In patients of MS, this is very common. So whether that TR murmur is because of organic tricuspid disease or it is functional TR because of pulmonary hypertension. That you differentiate by TR murmur, which may be absent in organic heard only in inspiration. So the Gallowardine sign that we know is done by increased inspiration or leg raising that you do is found in organic TR. JVP may not be elevated in functional, it is of course A wave and large V wave is present, and inspiratory increase in the loudness of the murmur will again, leg raising will tell you, but hepatomegaly edema are not a feature of organic because of the compliance of the RA. Hence the functional TR is one where you'll get right heart failure findings more early. Severe TR, you can get head bobbing, proptosis, systolic motion of the earlobe, hepatomegaly, pulsatile liver, ascites, and engorged neck veins. The older theory of valvitis, I'll just cover some last few slides. Older theory of mechanism valvitis that there was valve edema, leaflet contracture, and cordage shortening, which leads to MR. But MR occurs due to annular dilatation, actually, now we know. It's elongation of the leaflet, which leads to the prolapse, and hence the altered coaptation, which is responsible for a posteriorly directed MR and hence development of McCollum's patch. Clinically, you will get soft S1 gallop because of MR, but you must remember that you can valvitis, you can still get loud S1 despite MR being present. Carrie-Coombs murmur is one of the systolic the mid-diastolic rumble. As I have told you multiple times, all the doubly named murmurs are mid-diastolic. If you don't remember the name by the fear of the exam, whatever two names are there are mid-diastolic. You're always right. Austin, Flint, Carrie, Coombe, Cole, Cecil, all those doubly named murmurs are diastolic murmurs. So that's basically Carrie-Coombe is the mid-diastolic murmur of mitral valvitis. There is no pre-systolic accentuation. It's a mid-diastolic heard at the apex. It suggests MR, moderately severe MR, as a result of increased flow. People now believe it's not valvitis, but the MR and the MR causing severe MR causing mid-diastolic flow rumble. Severity of MR has a prognostic importance, as we know. Silent carditis is something that can always save your skin. can occur in 2 to 8% of ARF. No clinical evidence of carditis is present in such patients, and TE is the only finding that can save. Now, once you've done this, how do you justify, once you've reached a diagnosis, ECG, X-ray and echo can tell you still what you're dealing with a dominant lesion. So apart from evidences of rheumatic activity, axis in ECG rather than the chambers tells you the dominant lesion. Don't go by LV is hypertrophied or RV is hypertrophied alone, because hypertrophy will ultimately reflect in the axis. So if your axis is rightward, in a patient with aortic and mitral valve disease, you're dealing with predominantly a mitral lesion. So axis goes with the severity of the valve. Axis is more important. Next comes rhythm. If you have AF, you're dealing with mitral. And next is the chamber. All the three matter, but axis matters the most. Same way in X-ray, which chamber is enlarged matters. But what matters more is whether you have pulmonary venous or arterial hypertension, which again tells you you're dealing with a mitral valve disease, which is dominant. If you don't have PVH, PAH, you're dealing with aortic valve disease. So remember, focus is not chambers, chambers and chambers. Focus is something else. Look at the axis and rhythm in ECG. Look at the venous and arterial hypertension in X-ray. Of course, echocardiography clinches the diagnosis, and cath is required for the hemodynamics. You know the World Heart Federation echo criteria. I need not touch upon them. Treatment of carditis also, we know steroids, aspirin, arthritis versus mild and moderate versus severe, you need to give steroids. And these are some, what is the difference between relapse, rebound and recurrence? Recurrence is defined as a new episode occurring after 8 weeks of stopping the treatment. 8 week is a very important aspect to define recurrence. Relapse is worsening, and when the patient is still being tapered off, occurs in 4%, you have new murmur, worsening murmur or cardiomegaly. Rebound is occurrence on the drugs being tapered actually, and the longer the duration, lesser is the chance of rebound. So that's why people switch over, keep a tapering dose 4 to 6 weeks and maybe longer. Secondary profile axis, we all know in India, it should be lifelong. In a high prevalence country we are. And chronic rheumatic fever is one terminology which was defined by Taranta and Feinstein, which basically is persistent of inflammatory activity for 223 days. This is a number that you should remember. Co-pathogen effect was defined by Brook, which basically when you give repeated penicillin, the oral flora will shift and, you know, cause beta-lactamase production. And these staphylococci that are present who have been become penicillin resistant will start degrading your penicillin and make streptococcus come back. So co-pathogen is that Gabsca co-pathogen is some other bacteria which is destroying the penicillin that you're giving by developing and producing beta-lactamase. And destroying them. Eagle effect is after rapidly dividing, Gabs can reach a stationary phase of growth, and in the penicillin may not be bactericidal to these organisms. They will continue to thrive there, and penicillin may be. So the tolerance of MIC by MBC, which is mini inhibitory by bactericidal, more than 32 is defined as tolerant specimen of Gabs. These are the various references that I had to share from which I have presented. Thank you very much. Thank you for patient hearing. If there are any questions, I can take them.
Thank you very much, sir.
Yes, Senthil, you've raised your hand. I hope I didn't go too fast. There's too much to talk, but I tried to cover as much as just to focus upon just these points of differentiating the dominant lesion, how to approach a multivalve. Senthil, you wanted to ask something? You raised your hand.
No, sir. No, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. In chat box, normal pressure slide, somebody wants to ask, showing normal pressures. Okay, I'll try to share the screen again. Is that the only question? Are you able to see my slides again? Are my slides visible?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Sorry. Are you seeing the slides?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Visible. Slides are visible.
Okay. So these two slides you should remember. One is this. The wedge pressures, the pathology, and the x-ray and the symptoms. So you may be asked, a patient has come with pulmonary edema. What do you expect in his lung histology? Or you may be asked, the patient's wedge pressure is 12 to 18. What do you expect as an x-ray? Or you may be asked, the patient has come with PND. What do you expect his chest x-ray to look like? So these are the correlates of the same. This is what you're asking for, the pressures. So mean RA, mean RVs, mean PA, capillary wedge, systemic vascular resistance. Systemic vascular, as I said, remember, I remember it 1 to 2 and 10 to 20. That's easy way to remember. Good units. And then somebody asking you in SI units, you multiply it by 80. So systemic vascular resistance is 10 times of pulmonary vascular resistance. And one good unit is what is normal for lungs. So peripheral is 10 to 20. And so RA is 1 to 5. RV, pulmonary capillary wedge, which is wedge is equal to LA. So it is 4 to 12. So pulmonary capillary wedge is the LA pressure, which is usually between 4 to 12. And these are the changes that you expect. And that should reflect in your x-rays and your findings and your symptoms and your pressures, etc. AF relates with severe of MS. Somebody has asked me, no. AF does not go beyond moderately severe MS. It can be moderate or it can be severe, but it doesn't happen in mild. AF goes more with chronicity and it also sometimes goes with severity.
Hello. Yes, sir. The points like 10 points which you said to decide dominance of lesion. But just sometimes we get
severity
like,
of lesion. 10 points are for severity of lesion, not dominance of lesion. 9 points I showed you differentiating between starting from history, duration.
Yes, sir. Sir, like if the patient is having a hyperdynamic apex with PH, then we should go for MS or we should go for MR as a dominant lesion.
So then that's the reason that you need to combine all 9 together.
Okay, so sir, out of 9,
you can have to... so you have to justify. Suppose you have findings of PH and you have dominant hyperdynamic apex. So MR can say dominant MR with significant MS.
Okay,
both are there. PH findings are there, but dominant MR because apex is hyperdynamic down and out. S1 is soft. There is presence of PH because of severe MR. You have to justify.
Okay, sir.
Then severe MR can cause PH to develop in later stages.
Okay, sir.
So loud as south sound, presence of pH, apex beat, character of the pulse. These all things we will have
to all. Yes, sir. All the findings we have to combine a number of finding in favor of one wall.
Yes,
then
we which can... is favoring what overall into the picture.
So, okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks.
All right, then if there are no further questions, we can end this session today. We can decide if you guys want X-ray and ECG, two things that I usually take for every batch, X-ray and ECG, separate lecture for X-ray and ECG. So we can decide whether we want to do it or not. Otherwise,
next week.
On Thursday, we are anyway doing a case. Jevin, you are present?
Yes, sir. Thursday, next week.
Thursday.